papers back last week. Wow! I can't believe that. Praise the Lord. If you didn't pray, you got to use your own tonight. I ain't going to get no more. Anyway, pass that around and everybody write down a copy of his address and give him a birthday card. Now you got to mail it Thursday or Friday because his birthday's on Sunday. All right, I would like for Harry or Keith Long, hey, we have a church, y'all can't be talking to you. Would you bring up Proverbs 29:18?
The computer's down right now, we're trying to reboot it.
Okay, somebody look up Proverbs 29:18. When you depend on technology, it's good when it's there. Jared, you have it, read it, please. Listen up.
Where there is no vision, people perish. But he that keepeth the law, happy.
All right, I want to concentrate on the first part of that phrase. Where there is no vision, the people perish. I can't express to you how important it is, not only for a church to have a vision, but to keep the vision. Now, how do we do that? How in the world do we keep the vision that's going before us and what we're going to be about? What? I didn't ask. In fact, I'm being rhetorical. I'm not asking. I don't want you to ask.
Well, that's the question you want to ask.
How do you keep that vision in front of the people is a $64 question. Okay? We're all talking about Acts 1:8. If I was a stranger or a new person who moved into the community, and I ran into you at the grocery store, and we found out that we were neighbors, and I asked you, said, I'm looking for a church, tell me about your church, what kind of response would you give to that particular person? Now, I don't want 100 responses. I want you to think in your mind what your response would be. I hope, Bob, I hope that y'all wouldn't say, well, that's the redneck church. That's what we are. We're the redneck church. That is the wrong answer, okay? We don't people come to redneck. Here's the answer that I would like for you to be able to give. And I want this ingrained in your mind, and I want to prove to you this is nothing new. We're not reinventing the wheel. We're just rehashing something that we've always been doing for the 20 years that we've been here. Somebody walks up to you in the grocery store and said, I'm looking for a good church. Tell me about yours. Well, we're an Acts 1:8 church. We believe in missions, and we believe starting in the local area, but even going to the states and the nation and to the world. Now, that is a good answer. And if you're really trying to attract people to your congregation, now, of course, you might add some things. We're a friendly congregation. But if you want to give a good scriptural answer, well, I want you to be ingrained in your mind because you will be approached sometime, somewhere, by somebody. We're an Acts 1:8 church. That's what we're all about. Now, I want to show you that I'm not inventing the wheel, okay? This was Faith Magazine, T and the D. This was a 2002 article, okay? I tried to print this off, but it was too dark. So y'all just, if you want to read it, you can come up here and read it. You can't have this. Anyway, this is the article that, the interview that they gave me. And look at the title. Can you read that? Mighty Commissions, okay? That was 2002. So we haven't changed. What we just want to do is kind of focus in on what we want to be and how we want to be that particular church of doing something for the Lord and His work here on earth. Now, we started out last week.
Let me find my notes.
We started out last week, and by the way, if you're interested, and I'm not necessarily going to use it, but there is a workbook on this. You go to Lifeway. Lifeway Christian Book. You can buy it for $8.95. It's a workbook on the Acts 1:8 challenge. Okay? So, and we talked about the four target areas, and we talked about what we do local, and we talked about how that fits into our plans, and we got through local, and we got through state, and we talked about things that we do and things that we don't do. come as a total congregation, and we want to be focused on things that we do as a church, not only local, not only state, but nationwide and worldwide. Now, when you talk about nation, how many of you know what the letters NAMB stand for? I see one. You better know. Anybody else? NAM?
North American
Mission Board. You probably already know that that used to be the Continental United States, but that has expanded. Now they include Mexico, they include Canada, and all the little islands around the area. That's considered home missions now because it's just come such a close-knit nation, okay? But when you hear about NAB, North American Mission Board, and you know that the offering that we use for that is Annie Armstrong, the lady who lived in Baltimore and had a vision. She was a WMU director. She wanted to carry the gospel throughout the United States, and she did that. She started being a missionary and started going westward and getting ladies trained to take the gospel westward. That was back before the West was tame, you know. So that kind of goes with that. Now, in the area of national missions, okay, we want to be focused. Let me tell you some of the things we've done and some of the things that we could do. We every year we do the West Virginia mission trip, okay? Most of you are aware of that. We include 10 churches that we minister to. We go to Covenant, where some of our people have been on mission trips. We go to Niagara, we go to Brush Fork, we go to Big Springs, we go to Panther, we go to Gilbert, we go to Lincoln, and we go to Isaban, and we go to Harbor Light. Now, we have a connection with Harbor Light because that is Harry's sister, Jim and Grace Davis, the ministers up there. We also have a Sunday school that supports them with the first offering every month. Y'all still do that, right?
No.
Y'all quit that? Why? None of my business?
Okay. Yeah.
Well, carry on.
Not just do with
you. Okay, never
they
mind.
They only did it for so many months.
Yeah. You what now?
They only did it for several months.
Okay, all right. Well, the last I heard, which probably was a year ago, that they would take off the first Sunday of the month and send you the human grace. Let me tell you, that's a good work. And they all need that, and that's a good thing for the church to be involved in, not just a Sunday school class. But you see, we got to keep the vision. We can't just lose this. And if we want to be Acts 1:8 church, we have to do things nationwide. Let me tell you some of the other things. When we went to, we worked through Samaritan's Purse. We've taken two trips. We've been to New York. I think Lynn and Bob were the ones that made the trip there. You probably already heard about it when Sandy hit. How many went to Oklahoma, Bruce? 10? We took a trip to Oklahoma on the bus. We were a little late, but we got out there and did what we could as far as working with them to help them recover. That was through Samaritan's Purse. The offering that we took up the other night is going through Samaritan's Purse to help people in need. Now, Samaritan's Purse is not a Southern Baptist work, but I like what they do and I like the approach they do. Everybody they help, they always give a Bible signed by everyone who has worked, and they always have prayer with the families. And they have many stories of people coming to faith in Jesus Christ through that. He said, well, why not go through the Baptist Disaster Relief? Got nothing against them? I am certified as a Baptist Disaster Relief myself. I know how to do mud out. I know how to do first response. I know how to do communications. But they work alongside Red Cross, okay? And they work, everything they do is intermingled with the Red Cross. But the Samaritan's Purse stands alone as a Christian ministry. If you've ever worked with the Red Cross, you know, and I'm not throwing rocks at nobody, okay? Understand, I'm just educating you. If you're working with the Red Cross, you know that you cannot use a Christian witness. I had a friend that helped with the shelter, and he was passing out gospel tracts. No, you can't do that here. Because this is an organization we want to reach all the people and help them, but we don't want to use any religious. So that's a catch there. You can't use religion when you're working with the Red Cross. Baptist Disaster Relief is still good. They still do good work, okay? That's something you want to be part of. That's okay. All right. You may or may not be aware that South Carolina has a 3-year partnership with New England Missions. Did you know that? Maybe because I didn't tell you. I think I did mention it one Sunday, but I haven't pursued it. And I have talked with one of the gentlemen up there who is the director of missions of the Greater Boston Association. He's been down to my church down and spoke. As a matter of fact, I went up to his church and visited him and his family, and they had just started a Spanish work. He wanted to come down last July, but I wasn't able. That was 2 years ago. I don't know, it was 1 or 2 years ago. We wanted to come down and share, but we weren't able to do that. But that would be a good partnership. And here's what I'm looking for. When you talk about national, you know, we can't all load up in a bus and go 46 hours away. We can't all do that. But here's what we could do. We could look at that little Spanish work that they had up there, and we said, hey, we want to partner with that particular group. And we'll send pictures. We could help with their church budget. We could send $200 a month or $100, something that we could do, and we could say, hey, we're Acts 1-8 Church because we are linked to a national need of a church within our nation that has a need. We can do the same thing with Isaban. Isaban, of course, is in West Virginia. Anybody that's been on a West Virginia trip knows about that. God is blessing this little church. I mean, after being stagnant for so many years and never having over 15 people, they're growing. They had baptism a couple weeks ago, and the Lord is just blessing, and we could partner with them. In the past, we've done block parties there. We always do the West Virginia Christmas. We've had block parties in Oceana. We partner with Harbor Light. But somewhere along the line, we need to focus and say, hey, let's create a year or a two-year partnership. And let's send mission teams, let's send literature, let's send money, let's them come down and be a part of our service. Let's a couple of people go and be a part of their service. And for just a couple of years, we will just be part of what they are. That's what I'm talking about. Okay? Now that's on a national level. Okay? Other things that we have done, we took a school items to the Louisiana flood victims. Many things. Okay? Anybody have anything they'd like to share? I remember the trip that we went to New York City and worked in the schools up there, painting the schools. This was an outreach of the New York Baptist Association. And another thing that we did that during the day, we went around Washington Park and we passed out DVDs of a new church work that was starting in one of the high-rise buildings there. And that was really good.
How about when y'all went to Canada?
Well, actually, the Canada trip is on here. Yeah, that's international. We hadn't got international yet, okay? Now, I know it's national now, but at that time it was international. Anyway, I got it under the international.
Oh. Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, we've done a lot. But what I want us to do, and here's how I like to do this. I like for everybody to do their homework. You know a group, this group, that group, preferably Southern Baptist, and you write a paragraph and you turn it into the deacons or the mission committee, and we would meet and we'd talk and say, let's present this to the church. We might even do scout work. We might go here and look at this work that's going on and say, yes, this is something we'd like to support. We could get the director of mission, Brother Ephraim Lopez, to come down and share. You'd love him if you met him. I remember he giving his testimony in the church that I was pastoring in. His words now, not mine. When God saved him, he was a drunk Catholic. Okay? And God gloriously saved him and made him a Southern Baptist. Anyway. But he's a tremendous servant of God. And his whole family is just tremendous. He's got 2 daughters. Now he's got grandchildren because he's been so long. But I would like for us to just take the bull by the horns and say, you know, we're going to find one church. Now let me throw this out to you. You know, we talked about the flood work. We know we took up offerings. I tried my best with the help of Miss Sandra back there to find Magnolia Baptist Church in Rockport because, you know, Rockport was one of the hardest hit areas with the flood. There is no Magnolia Baptist Church. Okay? I talked to the Baptist Convention. They have no record of the Magnolia Baptist Church. However, all that said and done, Harry found the tombstone. Amos Rook, beloved pastor of Magnolia Baptist Church, 1897. So one of two things happened. There was either a name change or the church dissolved. Okay? But if it changed its name, I would love to find that congregation and make a partnership. Hey, we know you and your parishioners had flood problems. We want to be your partner in helping you. congregations for a period of time to be determined by the congregation how long we're going to link up these people. It's in Rockport, Texas. It's in Aransas County, Rockport, Texas. And you ain't going to find it. But me and Harry can't find it. It's gone unless it's changed its name. Huh? Sandra, she had people looking. She couldn't find nobody.
No, I had Pastor Joe look for it. He said he couldn't find it.
Now, what denomination is Pastor Joe? Is he Southern Baptist?
Yes.
Okay.
Just about as loud as you are.
Thank you for that. Wayne Goldman and his wife Elaine, they are the founders of it. And that's part of our church through John and Gail. It's something that we have an opportunity to be a part of. Okay. Tell me some of the others. All right, we talked about some things we've done. Here's what I'd love to see happen. I'd love to see us find a church in somewhere that we know about, whether it be Mexico, whether it be Canada, whether it be Peru, whether it be Romania, and say, hey, that's a church that we could help. And we would find somebody who is like-sized congregation, you know, run the 100-something Sunday school maybe, or, you know, around that area, and say, and let's team up, let's partner with this church. And to be honest with you, it might end up just being a monetary thing. Said, we know you're Southern Baptist, so we know that you get a salary through the cooperative program. But here's what we'd like to do. We'd like for you to put our church in your budget, or rather, vice versa. We put their church in our budget. And we'll send you $200 a month to help your church function. Maybe they need Bibles. I don't know. He said, hey, man, this is great. Let's just get a bunch of Bibles and ship them to Peru. We did that in Mexico. They needed a Spanish Bible down there. So I don't remember who even bought the Bibles. I think it was Don Johnson, because he went with us when we took the lumber over. He took the box to get in Bibles and delivered them so that the church could have Spanish. Everybody in the church could have a Bible. Listen, these are things that we are about. They're simple things, but they're things that we really need to focus in on if we're truly going to be mighty commissioned. And I think we ought to get involved. I think we ought to focus our efforts. I think we ought to do this as a church. And I think we ought to promote it in all the Sunday school classes. I want to put a banner on the wall. I think we already got that approved, don't we, Bruce? Yeah. That we'll put a banner on the wall, Acts 1:8. And all those four areas will be our target areas. And we will start working earnestly to reach those, or find four people or four churches that we can work with to spread the gospel. Tell me what you think. Tell me your ideas. I'm open to hear. You've been listening to me talk. You talk a little bit. Don't sit there dumbfounded. Come on.
Well, I think for one thing, we need to do our homework.
Absolutely.
Before choosing the mission, because, you know, it don't make me feel good to help somebody that don't need help. They really do need help, and God puts us in a position to do that.
Okay.
That's a wonderful lesson to be able to help somebody like that.
All right, let me ask you a thing. Do you think the church in Mexico needs help? From what you've seen in experience?
College we went to?
No, not the college now, the church. Our New Falls church.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. I know that you bought chairs for the church, right?
Yeah,
you admit he bought the chairs for the church. That's the kind of thing I'm talking about. And I'm talking about, hey, maybe they need hymn books. Maybe they need an overhead projector. We don't know what their needs might be. But in every congregation, there's always needs, okay? And especially in mission work. And this would be above and beyond what we do through the cooperative program. I really think that as Southern Baptists, we use that as a cop-out. That I write the check and we send the money, but we don't want to do any hands-on work. And that's just not the way we ought to function in a congregation. We ought to do something. And you see, we could invite them to come here. We could put the pictures up on the walls that this is a missionary that we are helping. This is a church that we're helping. And you know, the opportunities are limitless. Limitless. But I agree with Bruce. You know, we all know we ought to do our homework. Don't know who we're helping. But I will say that there's not a church that's specifically a church that's preached the gospel of Jesus Christ that doesn't have some need somewhere, right? Especially when they're in the mission field. Okay. All right, here, somebody else.
It's not Southern Baptist, but I know that Lynn would like to talk with y'all. His cousin Tommy, I've mentioned him before, I mentioned him a few weeks ago.
Right.
Mr. Bob preached.
Uh-huh.
He has got the Gospel of God Ministries. And for lack of a better term to describe Tommy, he's kind of a But it's really kind of amazing to see what Tommy does. I think it takes a certain boldness to do the things that he and his group does. And he has been really wanting to come and speak.
Does he want to come and speak?
He would love to come and speak.
Well, we'll get him on the program. Have a way of expressing themselves, and the only way they know how to express themselves is with a negative. Okay? And that's just the way they are.
Well, a lot of people, my experience has taught me that a lot of people think you're supposed to just do stuff locally. Why are we doing stuff in Texas? Why are we doing stuff we should be doing?
Right,
locally.
Right. I hear that all the time. Okay, Mr.